Okay, well, that's turned over to 203, and I think that's all the time we can afford to spare. Welcome, everyone. My name is Steve Kenzie. I'm the Executive Director of the UN Global Compact Network UK. We are delighted to have you here for the sixth and final session in our Black Lives Matter and Business webinar series. I'll take this moment to give a special thanks to NatWest Group for their generous support of this series, without which we would not have been able to take it forward. We have, I think, a great program on offer for you today. We've been building up to this, and we're really delighted, I think, to sort of a crowning glory with this session. We are in webinar mode, which means you, as the audience, do not get to unmute and speak, but we strongly encourage you to post your questions in the Q&A box and post your chat in the chat box. And we're going to have plenty of time later on for questions. Okay, well, that's the housekeeping out of the way. So let's just get quickly started. Every webinar in the series has started off with a brief introduction to the UN Global Compact, just in case you're not already aware of what we do. So the Global Compact Network UK is part of the world's largest responsible business initiative, connecting companies and other organizations in a global movement dedicated to driving sustainable growth. There are over 12,500 companies around the world that have signed up to this initiative. To join, it takes a CEO commitment to operationalize our 10 principles that are in the human rights, labor, environment, and anti-corruption themes. Those need to be operationalized in your company. You need to commit to reporting annually on your progress and commit to supporting the wider UN agenda. We at the UK Network offer a range of engagement opportunities to help companies fulfill those commitments. And we hope, if you're not already a member, you will certainly have a look and consider joining us going forward. Now, we feel that Black Lives Matter is absolutely central to our agenda. And on the screen now, you can see on the left are 10 principles of the UN Global Compact, and on the right, the Sustainable Development Goals. And the lines in between are showing how the highlighted principles that are directly relevant to the Black Lives Matter agenda link across to Sustainable Development Goals and the highlighted goals that also directly link into this agenda. So this really isn't something new. Everyone that signed up to Global Compact has, as part of their commitment, the elimination of discrimination in respect of employment and occupation. Obviously, the events of this year and years beyond have really brought it much, much more into focus that for one important constituency within our society, Black people, we're not doing enough to address that discrimination. And so we've certainly taken it on to do our part and try to support companies in doing more in this regard. And we're really delighted that we've had such support from our great speakers and audiences. Now, I'm going to pass on to my colleagues, Cynthia and Carla, who are really the brains and the muscle behind this whole series, to just say a few words about the series and how we got here.
Thank you, Steve. Hi, everyone. If this is the first time you're joining us or you have actually been coming to every single event, welcome. I think I would be remiss not to say how this whole thing started. I think when George Floyd died and the Black Lives Matter movement picked up, it personally had a huge impact on me. Everything just seemed really bleak and hopeless in terms of who I was in society and how people receive me as an individual, especially within corporate culture. And I knew that we really, as the UN Global Compact Network UK, needed to be doing something about it. I put it to the team, and there was really good feedback. And so Carla and I developed this three-part webinar series. What we wanted to do especially was to create a series with concrete actionable points that companies can take away and actualize within their organizations. We had joined quite a few webinars that sprung up really early on in June. And what we realized were a lot of them were just kind of, you're just listening in to somebody else's conversation. And what we wanted was that it wasn't just listening in, but you could actually take away tangible steps. And so we created a 6-part webinar series that you can see in front of us. The first one was all about storytelling and harnessing the power of storytelling. The second was about where to start. So looking at language, anti-racist training, and the juxtaposition that it has between unconscious bias training. And we also looked at the ethnicity pay gap reporting. And then we had a recruiting webinar in which we had the CEO of Bain Recruitment come and speak to us about what is the issue and what are things that companies need to be doing when it comes to recruitment of Black talent. And then also with the retention and advancement webinars, it's about how to retain the Black talent that you already have and how to allow them to progress on or to change from the role that they're in to a different role. And today we have change in corporate culture. I just want to say that I, for one, am extremely pleased and happy with how this whole webinar series has gone. And I speak for both Carla and I when I say that it was our desire that as many people as possible, as many organizations as possible, had an opportunity to listen in, hear what the great points, the gold points that have been shared, and to take it back to their organizations to do something about it. Carla, if you are available, have I missed anything out?
Hi, everyone. I think my internet is a bit laggy, but hopefully now. I just wanted to add that organizing this series and seeing how well it's been received by members and it's been really lovely. And we have had well over 2,500 registrants in total throughout the series. So I just wanted to thank everyone on Cynthia's behalf and on my behalf for attending and for learning and for providing us with valuable feedback about the series as a whole. And I genuinely hope that everything we've covered with these 6 webinars will really help you and make some lasting change for your Black staff. And we won't leave it at this either. So in this series, we've talked about how one-off trainings, one-off sessions and events don't really work. So we're planning various follow-ups for this series. In mid-December, we will have a business guidance note, which details specific actions that your business can take right now in support of the movement. And this note will be informed by the learnings and key from the series. And by the way, you can check all the webinars, all the past recordings on the link that I put in the chat. And we will also have more BLM and business events and was coming out in 2021. So keep your eyes peeled. Follow us on our site and social media for more updates on what's coming next. And of course, if you have any feedback, suggestions for what specific themes or issues you'd like us to cover in 2021, please email either myself or over to you, Cynthia, now.
Thank you, Carla. So I'm just going to quickly go over the agenda for today. It's pretty straightforward. We've just had a welcome by Steve and Carla and I just kind of sharing about the Black Lives Matter movement, webinar series. And then we're going to have an amazing panel discussion with our wonderful panelists. And then which will also include a Q&A. So please do put your questions in the Q&A box so that we can get them answered for you. And then finally, we'll have a final call to action and final remarks from our CEO and Executive Director, Zander Ogyambo. I'm just gonna hand over to Steve now. Thanks.
Thank you, Cynthia. Thank you, Carla. Yes, a simple but strong agenda. So we are delighted to be joined for our panel discussion by Kevin Ellis, from PwC, Kate Rowlandson from Mediacom, Marcia Balasiano, our network chair, but today representing both Global Compact and RELX Group, and Sam Okafor from NatWest Group. And when we go into our when we go into our first round of questions, I'll ask you all to please just tell us a little bit more about your role and your organization. So I'm thinking we're going to start just in that same order as you appeared on that slide, if that's okay. So that means, Kevin, you're up first. And the question I'd like to start with, this whole point of this webinar is, you know, changing corporate culture and a bit of a view from the top, getting, you know, senior management, your perspective on how to make change. And so the first question, which argument do you find stronger for shifting behaviors and culture in your organization in order to move this agenda along? Is it the business case or is it the moral imperative? I think you're muted, Kevin.
Steve, do you want me to jump in while we see if we can unmute Kevin? I was just going to say, especially because if I come toward the end, everyone is already going to say my answer, which is that I don't think it's mutually exclusive. I think it is both of those things. It is the moral imperative, and it is the need that we have within our organizations to make the changes that have to happen to ensure that we walk the talk. We've been saying for a number of years as business, or, you know, and certainly in the UK and in the US and other places, that we want to be inclusive. Now we need to do the work. And part of that is about changing the culture, which we're going to talk about today. But I don't think it's an either or. I definitely think it's an and.
Thanks, Marcia. Kevin, I heard some static.
I'll try. Is that okay?
Yes.
Oh, perfect. Cool. Thank you very much. Sorry about that. And good afternoon, everyone. Yeah, I agree with Marcia. I think it's really important that businesses take the lead here, because not only do we influence our people, my organization in the UK employs 22,000 people. So there's huge expectation from our people to see what leaders are saying, see the culture they're setting and the values that they're displaying. So I think it's really important that leaders speak up on this issue, both for the people, because at the end of the day, we all compete for talent. So unless you are speaking up on these issues as a leader of a business, then I don't think you get the economic benefit from it. But at the same time, business is part of society. We have clients, we link into society, and therefore business can be a convener of change too. And I think, again, on this issue, which is so important to everyone, I've never heard it discussed so many times by so many CEOs that I interact with. So I think, as I say, business has an opportunity, it is mutual, to both change for the benefit of their organization, for the economic good, but at the same time, change for the impact on society that business has as both a convener and an employer.
Thanks, Kevin. Kate, maybe tell us a little bit about Mediacom first, and then your take on this question.
Sure. Hi, everybody. Really happy to be here today. I'm the CEO for Mediacom in the UK. So we are in the advertising business. So we advise our clients on how they should invest and allocate their marketing and media investment in the context of their advertising campaigns. And then we plan and we buy and we measure those campaigns. So advertising is the field, the category, the industry that I represent today. And yeah, I mean, look, I think, you know, the way I like to talk about this is that driving diversity and building inclusive culture is the right thing to do. Okay. And one of the very great benefits of driving an inclusive culture is that it's great for business. So I think first and foremost, it's the right thing to do. And I agree with the comments from my previous panelists. I mean, what I would like to add to that though, is the problem and the potential issue with talking about the economic and the business benefits is the pressure that this potentially puts on Black people and other marginalized groups. So there, it could be construed in a way that people have to justify their existence. So, you know, white people have never had to justify the fact that they largely run companies. So why should other marginalized groups have to justify their existence? So I think this is the potential issue with the business case for diversity, is that people shouldn't feel pressured to, you know, be present in a business in a senior role, for example. So I think the way I like to talk about it within the context of Mediacom is that we are in the advertising business. So we are trying to reach all of the people in the UK to advertise our clients' products to. So it's really important for me that I have in my business lots of diverse groups who can represent the population of the UK and therefore do a better job for our clients. So I think it's important for me that we have those voices in our organization.
Thanks, Kate. Sam, same question for you, Ed, but interested again, maybe tell us a little bit about your role in NatWest. And if, I don't know, do you feel you have enough to say about that question, or should I give you another question as well?
Yeah, I'm happy to build on that. But look, first of all, okay, I want to start off by saying a massive well done to you, Steve, to Carla, and to Cynthia for putting on a fantastic series and really keeping the conversation alive. I mean, we're here talking today about culture, and in order to change the culture, the conversation needs to continue. And I think the series have definitely achieved that. So a massive well done for that. And also a thank you for giving us NatWest Group the opportunity to be able to sponsor this series. So a massive well done, and a big thank you for giving us the opportunity to sponsor the series. To the question that you asked in terms of the business imperative or the moral imperative, the business case or the moral imperative, I agree. I think it's so important that firstly that we recognise the moral duty that we have to deliver equal access of opportunities and services to those that interact with us as an organisation. And I think secondly, it's really important for us to establish the correlation between the increased workforce diversity and the improved performance and high levels of innovations that come by having a diverse workforce. I think those are really, really important points as well. And as an organisation, since June, we have been developing a report called The Banking on Racial Equality, a Roadmap for Positive Change. And we set out a set of 10 commitments and 2 targets that will enable us to be able to build an open and an inclusive and a progressive organisation. And these are the steps that we're taking to be able to champion the potential of our people, families and businesses, and really helping to break the glass ceilings as well, and really bring about the cultural change that we want to see across the organisation.
Thanks, Sam. What you've just said ties in really nicely to one of the questions that's already come in, and maybe we'll share that around, because I think that's a really important point. Is the question from Maxine is, how will corporate organizations be held accountable for the actions they're claiming to sign up to? So you've got your 10 points. Are they in the public domain? What are the consequences for not making them? And then maybe, you know, do any of our other panelists have, you know, similar accountability mechanisms around this agenda? Sam?
So Steve, we set out in June, following the death of George Floyd, sad death of George Floyd, to really take time to listen and to learn and to understand the lived experiences of our colleagues. And rather than rushing out of a set of commitments, we were really keen to listen and to learn and to understand the lived experiences from our colleagues. And in doing so, having done that for the last 4 or 5 months, or we continue to do that, we published a report called Banking on Racial Equality, Roadmap for Positive Change. And these details, as I've mentioned, the commitments that we're taking to champion the potential and remove the glass ceilings of that are currently faced by our Black, Asian, minority, ethnic customers, colleagues, and communities as well. We set a 10 set of commitments and two targets. One was an existing target. We set a new target, which is focused on Black representation of our senior leaders in the UK. We've published those commitments internally, and we've also published them externally as well, so everyone can get access to the report and the commitments. And we're committed to following through on those commitments and those targets and continually publishing our progress against how we're doing against those 10 commitments and those targets as well. The commitments that we published are based on the research that we've done internally and externally to really understand the challenges rather than rushing out. It's a thoughtful piece of work that we've done to really understand the challenges that are currently faced by our Black colleagues, customers and communities as well, and to really understand what we can do as an organisation, because we recognise as a purpose-led organisation we have a responsibility to take action.
Thanks, Sam. Is there a volunteer to build on that? Yeah, Kevin?
Yeah, sure. Look, I think there's a lot of truth in what gets measured gets done. So I think there is an importance in shining a spotlight. And I think data makes a big difference here. So since 2017, we've shared published our ethnicity pay gap data. And I've got to say, you know, at times it's been embarrassing. I can tell you that back in 2017, when we first shared it, my young teenage daughter actually texted me to say, "Are you really paying Black people 10% less than white people, Dad?" Which is obviously very uncomfortable. I had to explain about what gender, what pay gap meant. And we were paying people the same amount of money for each, for whatever job they were doing. But at the same time, this was due to the fact we hadn't promoted or got to the senior positions the right mix. And therefore, that was something we had to focus on. So therefore, not only have we published that, we've set targets at every grade, and we've set about a plan to do that. And we're both publishing it every year. Again, I think it makes you accountable externally as well as internally, which again, I think is attractive to your people, but at the same time, avoids you ducking the issue. So, you know, I agree with what Sam's done with NatWest. I think we have to be public in what we're doing to hold ourselves accountable and to shine the light. At the same time, it's sometimes hard to get that data. People don't necessarily want to share that data. We found it hard. We had to advertise and strongly encourage people to share it. Initially, probably only about 60% of our people shared that data. We're now up to about 90%. So again, that is helpful in terms of making us more transparent as an organization, which I think is important to our clients as well as our people.
Just before going to...
Maybe, I was just going to add maybe first a word about who RELX is in case people don't know our organization. I like to think of us as the world's knowledge company. We're focused on advancing science and health, looking at data and analytics to protect society and reduce inequalities. We also focus on promoting the rule of law and access to justice through our legal business. And we're also about fostering communities as one of the world's largest events companies. So I could not agree more with Samuel and Kevin that we absolutely need to be transparent. We have to be willing to share the news that isn't all so rosy, and that's not always comfortable for companies because we're in the business of trying to tell the good news. But in our case, we set as one of our publicly stated corporate responsibility objectives for 2020 that for the first time we would develop a suite of inclusion goals. Behind the scenes, so it's something we've been working on this year and we're not done yet, we will release those when we do our public reporting in early 2021 in February, about middle of the month, watch for that. We will say what those goals are, but certainly behind the scenes, the tragic circumstances that Samuel was mentioning, the death of George Floyd, the need to look at systemic racism and what we as an organization need to do our part really has accelerated the conversation. So we will have a race and ethnicity quantitative target, and then more generally across the piece for inclusion, we'll also have some qualitative things that we'll be doing. What are the policies that we're engaged in? how are we recruiting? And in the case of Black colleagues, particularly in the US, where we have our largest operations and we're about 30,000 plus people around the world in 40 countries, but in the US, that's where we have the most people. We need to be looking at what the picture is there in terms of how, you know, what does our data show, and how do we take the aspiration of where that data is today and how do we advance that, for example, by recruiting with historically Black colleges and universities. So we've always done some of that, but how can we do more of that going forward? And then I think also a piece of work that we've involved our strategy colleagues on, and I think that's part of the conversation as well, is just making sure that it's certainly not the domain of my relatively small team, it's everybody's responsibility in the organization and getting all the bright minds working on it. So our very smart colleagues in strategy have been doing a piece of work looking at, you know, what are the drivers? How do different groups, including Black and in the UK, Black, Asian, minority ethnic employees, how do they fare in terms of their development? Are they scoring less in their personal development plans than other employees? How are they being able to be developed in terms of, do they have the same types of opportunities to advance in the organization? Are they part of our internal hires? And of course, you know what I was mentioning before in terms of how we bring people into the organization. Are we saying to the people who help us with our recruitment, it's got to be a diverse slate of candidates? And maybe we've been more apt to focus on gender, but we need to do that on race and ethnicity as well going forward.
Thanks, Marcia. Kate, did you want to come in?
Yeah, sure. I mean, I really couldn't agree more with Kevin about what gets measured gets done. So we have set targets across MediaCom UK, but I think the important development for me is that we've now done this at a team level. So every team, every person leading a team within MediaCom UK across all of our five offices knows exactly where they are. So what's the current situation in terms of the diversity level, you know, diversity by level, because the big challenge that we have is very, very simple as an organization, which is we need stronger representation at senior levels in the company. So we have very good gender diversity at a senior level, but we do not have Black, Asian, minority ethnic representation at senior levels in the business. So this is the singular objective for our company right now. We've set targets at team level. So that was important for me because I think having a corporate goal can sometimes be, if you're in a team, you're like, oh, well, someone else is dealing with that. It actually forces accountability right through the business. So this is a very important step for us. I think targets can be very controversial because I think one of the things that I worry about is Black people, so this is a Black Lives Matter webinar, Black people feeling that they have been promoted or recruited to hit a target, okay? And it's not about their talent and their capability. And I think that is a concern that I have. So I think we are, in the way that we communicate, very clear about the fact that all promotions and recruitment is done on merit. You are not hitting it. We don't have quotas and we're not, you know, it's not about hitting a target. All progress is celebrated. So I think the other issue with targets if they're too hard and fast, it becomes a bit tokenistic, or it can become tokenistic. So I think we talk about targets in the longer term, so 3 to 5 years. And I also celebrate all progress, right? So better is what I'm looking for. Any progress is good. So I think, you know, yes, we're setting targets, we're setting them at a team level, but I also think we have to be sensitive around how we communicate that. I mean, the other important thing to talk about as well from a data perspective is understanding your culture and how you measure belonging in an organization. So we have, we're part of WPP, so we have a WPP belonging survey in the UK, where all agencies within the group have been, you know, all of our people have been surveyed. as to how they feel in the organization. And what that's been hugely instructive. So what that enables us to do is look at the difference in experience in certain groups. So what we have seen, for example, is that if you're a white man, your lived experience in MediaCom can be very, very different on certain measures to that of a black woman, for example. And that allows us, once we've got that data, we can really start to address those very specific issues. So one of the things that we've done, for example, is to open up our internal promotion process. So one thing that came out of our belonging survey was that people don't always think that promotions go to the most deserving people. And that is more exacerbated in certain minority groups. And what we've done, therefore, is we've opened up and completely changed our internal promotion process, all open roles are advertised, and there's just a much more open process. So I think it's important to have data in terms of diversity, but also belonging, you know, because there's no point in bringing in lots of black people into your organization if they leave in 6 months because they don't feel that they belong and that they've experienced a microaggression. So I think both things are really important to look at.
You've given me a lot to work with here. I have a number of follow-up questions, and sometimes you answer them before I get to them, but I think first I'd like to dig in a little deeper, maybe with some of the other panelists, into that targets, quotas, tokenism nexus, and how does that all fit together? There's an interesting comment that came through in the chat. I think someone, yes, tokenism is okay to start. That is a question. Is it better to be the token black person than to not have a black person at all in a team? Or so interested to hear. Yeah, maybe start with you, Sam. That view on targets, quotas, tokenism, and what's the right balance, and how do you navigate that? Because it's so difficult.
Yeah. So look, as an organization, we set targets back in 2018 off the back of the Parker and the McGregor-Smith review. And we set a target to have 14% of our Black, Asian, minority ethnic colleagues in senior UK roles by 2025. At the ending of quarter three this year, we were at 10%. We're up 2% against the target that we set ourselves back in 2018. And one of the dangers that we've recognised is that actually, by having a focus on BAME, and you might have had people talking about the term BAME, is that you actually lose the challenges that the ethnic groups within that BAME face. And one little piece of work that we did as part of our Banking on Racial Equality review was to really actually break down actually where people sat within the umbrella of BAME. And we recognised that actually our black colleagues were underrepresented quite significantly against our black colleagues. And we set a target to address that actually. So we set a target of 3% of our black colleagues being senior roles by 2025. So I think, to Kate's point, I think Kate articulates that a point really well in terms of targets. I think targets are really important, and they help us to focus and have put some real good interventions in order to have better representation. I think that's really, really important as well. I think the culture in how you deliver the targets is really important as well. I think that's the key thing. Targets with the wrong culture will produce bad results, but targets with the right culture, putting the right interventions, expecting people to follow the right behaviours, setting those as part of the annual objectives, those are really key interventions to really change the culture. And to Kate's point, celebrating, you know, all promotions, that's really, really important. So I'm a firm believer of targets. I'm delighted that my organisation, our organisation, NatWest Group, has got targets. And I know that, you know, with the right culture, we'll deliver on those targets and, you know, make it a great place to work for everyone.
Thanks, Sam. Marcia, Kevin, did you want to weigh in on that? I got lots more to come, so it's okay if we want to move on.
Well, look, Steve, I have to say a couple of words. Yeah, I agree with Sam on culture. I mean, one of the things we do is, as well as measuring the both the pay gap publicly We also look at the staff levels, the flow rates through the organisations, and I think more organisations will look at flow rates, because I think that whole retention point that Kate referred to is so, so important. You can't be tokenist, and you need to look at the engagement scores, and the engagement scores in terms of background is really important. And also, again, goes to the economic good. You know, we're the number one social mobility employer in the UK. We have to be, because in the economic good, we work for all right across wider society in the UK. So we've got to reflect our marketplace. So again, that goes without saying. But in terms of flow rates, I think being absolutely honest and transparent, the number of people that join us who are Black is 3%. 3 years in, that number has risen to 6% of our organization. So again, that's encouraging that not only are we employing people, but people are staying. But when you get to the senior levels at Partner, that level is only 1%. And that's been publicly shared with the media. We've talked about that. We've also talked to the board about the need to double that and commit to double that over 5 years. Because again, we need the role models as well as the people. And again, but I say we are encouraged by the steps forward. I think, again, by having targets and being open about our failings and where we need to improve and the steps we're taking to improve, I think it's important for all our people to see, because then they know it's an equal opportunity organisation. They know they'll get their chance too. And at the same time, I think it's important for wider society, because people often ask me, what are you doing? How's it working? What more can I do? So I think there's a convener role as well for all of us as business leaders, which is why I think being on panels like this as a business leader are really important, that people to see us talking up on this issue.
I just want to pick up, Steve, something around the culture piece, which the colleagues have mentioned. And I agree, targets with the wrong culture is just not going to work. Just on the point of how we foster that, so we need to measure the culture. So we did at RELX the first culture survey that we've ever done. So that was quite interesting. And that was alongside the kind of pulse surveys that we do. So digging in with the culture questions are important. I think it's also how we're training and what kinds of training opportunities that we offer. So we've got two that I think are really interesting and new for us this year. One is around courageous conversations. How can we empower people to say what they feel they need to say? And then also around psychological safety. How can we make sure that people feel that they can be empowered to act in the ways that they want to be able to achieve what they want to do? And I think this is only more so important given the kind of year that we've all had of more isolation, challenging news, maybe feeling powerless to affect change. So finding ways that we can empower employees, I think it's really critical from the training. Of course, we've got the absolutely core training that everybody, including the CEO, does around avoiding harassment, for example. But we need these other types of things that are a bit more informal, that really encourage people to talk amongst one another and not feel constrained.
Thank you. Thanks, everyone. I find my thinking now is aligned again with Maxine from the question about timing. We've acknowledged difficulties in getting diversity into senior management roles, and I imagine we all have different perceptions about what fast and slow looks like with regard to achieving that senior management diversity that everybody wants to see. I would be interested in your views on that. Global Compact is just in the process of announcing its SDG ambition business benchmarks that align with the SDG targets to 2030. That probably feels like quite a long time for people that are in middle management right now looking for change. Could we speak to that idea of how fast and what sort of urgency do we need to bring to this? I think that links in a little bit to the targets, and at what point do we say it's not happening fast enough, we need to be more ambitious? volunteer to start? Kate, are you reaching for your mute button? Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, the frustration I have is that, you know, we're just not moving quickly enough. And we're trying to change our recruitment process and procedure and policy in order to accelerate. But, you know, one of the frustrations I have is that, you know, we've talent mapped the UK marketplace, and what I keep hearing and what my team and our HR teams are telling me is that the available talent pool just isn't there. So my answer to that is, really? You know, I kind of think, you know, okay, so if that's true, because we've done the due diligence, how then can we accelerate greater representation in our business? And I think one of the things that we're discussing at the moment is that we have to look outside of our industry. So I think that the normal way of recruitment is that you fish in the pool of your industry. And I think what I believe we need to do more of is look outside of our industry. Now, that brings challenges to you as a business, because then you have to invest significantly more in training and onboarding, because the people that you're hiring into the business are not experienced in your core industry. So this is just one of the things that we're looking at. But, you know, I think what I seem to be bumping up against a lot is the availability of talent at senior levels in Black, Asian, minority ethnic groups is just not there. So we have to look wider. We have to widen the search. And so realistically, I think that is going to take longer, impatient though I am. So we are looking at kind of 3 to 5 years. But again, any progress that we can make quicker than that, I will celebrate. And yeah.
Anyone else want to weigh in on that?
Steve, Yeah, I think it goes to those points that Kate made earlier. I think we do need to fish in different pools and recruit more widely. One thing we've noticed, and we're a big recruiter, we recruit 4,000 people a year, but we've shifted to taking more school leavers now. Again, that has given us more data around social mobility, more opportunity for others. And also we've found by creating offices in areas that are kind of cold spots in the UK, like Bradford, again, our share of recruits from disadvantaged backgrounds has increased. So again, it's a different way of approaching the same challenge that Kate said, not just going outside our industry, but effectively going into different pools, school leavers, apprentices, and going to different regions and cold spots in the UK. We've found as a way of increasing effectively our diversity of recruit. And then again, it's about retention and flow rates that move from 3% to 6% over those 3 years. That makes a difference. And again, as a big training organization, that is creating more opportunity for people that don't just stay with us, they leave as well, but they influence other organizations too, which again is kind of part of our culture and part of how I think we make a positive contribution to the wider society.
Steve, I'll add, I think from colleagues coming into the organization, I think we do a good job. We do a relatively good job in terms of people coming from our intern programs, our graduate programs. I think, you know, in the main, I think we do a really good job. I think where we do need to accelerate, and I guess many organizations will feel the same, is we do need to pull through when people come into the organization. How can they pull through into the senior roles? And I have to say, there is black talent out there. There's black talent within our organization. There's black talent that exists outside of our organization. And we need to break the barriers that stop black talent from fulfilling their full potential. That's fundamentally really important. And we need to have strong interventions. So in terms of timings, I want us to accelerate on this agenda. That's fundamentally really important. We need to make the black colleagues within the organization, black, Asian, minority, ethnic colleagues, to be able to fulfill their potential. We have to work really hard to break those barriers down. And there's barriers in, you know, interviewing processes, you know, biases that play out. We have to really make sure that we break those barriers down so people really can see role models that look like them and be able to progress through the organization. I think to your point in terms of, you know, how fast, I think we should accelerate on it. And I think we should do it in a sustainable way as well. So as we pull through talent up the organization, we make sure we surround them with great support and great help as well. That's fundamentally really important as well.
Thanks, Sam.
Can I just add that I totally agree. This is not a problem of the pool. We just have to do a better job in making sure that we are being more inclusive in how we bring people into our organizations. But I think it's also incumbent on each organization to think about how, through their own advocacy, they can make a difference within their industry. So as an example for us, say with the Elsevier Foundation, that's the science part of our business, we've got a project on with historically Black colleges and universities that are involved in nursing programs. How can we make sure that the people who are going to be the customers of the future are getting the progression and are representing the communities that they are representative of? So I think we need to look at what are we good at and how can we do that? We have another project on that's going to really take shape next year, which is looking at health disparities, particularly with Black and minority groups. So, why are there health disparities and what can we do about that? And when we get right back to the research and how it's conducted, so we really need to kind of, if we're looking at systemic things, we really need to pull right back and then use the expertise that we have to ensure that in our respective fields that we're helping to improve that long-term pipeline, to improve the knowledge that's out there.
Thank you all. I'm looking at the clock and we're burning through our time very quickly, and the questions are piling up. I'd like to maybe just come to a few of you with more targeted questions that have been coming in. I'm going to start with you, Kate, because there was a really interesting question about the backlash on social media regarding the Sainsbury's Christmas advert. And there was another point just about the perceived cynicism of companies using so many Black people in advertising, because I could certainly see a flip side that there'd be equally lots of complaints from different quarters if they weren't. And how do you approach that? What's the industry view?
Yeah, I mean, I think just to acknowledge, I was absolutely just horrified by that reaction to the Sainsbury's ad. I just want to acknowledge how horrific I felt that was. And I think that actually the way that Sainsbury's have responded to that, I think was to be applauded. I mean, one of the things that we do, because we've been speaking a lot about corporate culture, but actually one thing that we've been pioneering within Mediacom in the industry is a capability actually in inclusive planning. So to take our belief and philosophy around inclusion and diversity into the work, directly into the work. So we've had an inclusive planning product for a long time, actually, for the best part of 10 years. But what we've done is we've relaunched this year inclusive planning, and we put it much more at the heart of the work that we do for our clients. So one of the things that I have mandated actually is that in annual planning, so the annual cycle of planning that we do for our clients, we have to be talking about inclusive planning. And what I mean by that is highlighting to clients what the opportunity is in targeting more diverse audiences for their business. So we've got a tool and an approach which clearly shows the business that clients are missing out on by not targeting certain demographic groups and diverse groups. So and this is an element that we're including in all of our plans for clients. And this team that we've built around inclusive planning is also working, they're also working with smaller media owners. So obviously the big media owners in the UK take most of the money, but we're trying to support more marginalized media owners and media outlets. I think that we also offer cultural consultancy. So it's not enough to just say, right, you need to target more Black people in your communications. You can't just go off and do that. You have to take time and do the work around what that means. You have to consult with people in those groups to understand what messages they, you know, want to hear and so on. So we've got a whole capability around inclusive planning, which is encouraging our clients to look at the whole of the UK. You know, if you want to sell products to the whole of the UK marketplace, you need to account for all of the diverse groups within the UK. So that's, you know, what we're doing. You know, horrific backlash to the Sainsbury's ad, but we are actively encouraging our clients to be more representative in their ads, not just with the people they represent, you know, the people they have in their ads, but also very nuanced approach to targeting and looking at all the different diverse audiences. I hope that answers the question.
I think that's a sound response. I was going to come to Kevin next because I had a question, probably a quick one to answer, but a follow-up from your introductory statement that I'm interested in going back to the decision to publish your ethnicity pay gap figures. That would be a bold move to do that today, let alone in 2017. And clearly PwC is a real leader in this space, but could you tell us a little more about the process? That must have been a high level decision to make, to put that into the public domain.
Yeah, I suppose it was. I suppose at the time it just felt the right thing to do. I think it's a bit like we talked right at the very start, Steve, and I think all the panelists agreed that I think it's important that the business leaders are willing to be transparent. And when things aren't as good, like publishing pay data that probably isn't as good as you'd like or feel as proud of it as you'd want to, you shouldn't duck away from it because shining a light is really important. So it was quite a bold move then. But again, one of the positives coming out of it is not only that we've improved since then and we've taken certain steps, like, again, fairer work allocation. We've taken steps to ensure that everyone has the equal chance, again, for flow rates to get the opportunity in work allocation rather than just a promotion round. So it's forced us, I think, as an organisation to look at the nuts and bolts of the organisation to ensure we're being fair at every level. And again, I think that is really important. But again, there's the convener role. Once we published our pay data, we put the pressure on others to do the same, which I think is an important role as a leading organisation, to be transparent for yourself, but also put the pressure on others. It's a bit like when there was a senseless killing around George Floyd. I personally did the live stream with a number of Black colleagues to all of our staff. We had 8,000 people watching that live. And again, a number of other CEOs followed me by doing the same in their organizations because they thought it was the right thing to do. So I think it is about personal leadership from the top on some of these things, even though I've got to admit, at times it's not easy and it is uncomfortable.
Thanks, Kevin. Sam, the one I wanted to ask you, just, I'm not sure anymore about it, but I'm going to put it out there. Because it's a specific question for NatWest about the time when you don't have targets anymore, and how I think the question is, you know, once targets are achieved, how do we keep this issue alive and not have any sort of recidivism, as it were, and slip back to old ways of working? Is that a risk that you perceive? Do you think once the culture, you know, achieving diversity targets, does that impact culture sufficiently that there would be no backsliding?
Look, I think we'd all love to be in a position where actually, you know, we have an inclusive workforce that is representative of the customers and the communities that we serve. I think every organization here and not here would love to be in that position. And actually, once those targets are achieved, then that's great. As long as it's done in the right culture, then actually you'll be able to maintain your representation. So actually, the point around culture and targets go hand in hand. That actually, if you're going to maintain representation and you do it in the right culture, then actually that should naturally flow on for years to come. If you do it in the wrong culture, then actually you'll slip back to bad behaviors. So the key here for businesses and for organizations is to, once you set those targets, is to make sure you have interventions with the right culture to make sure that you maintain and sustain what you're trying to achieve. I think that's fundamentally the key point here.
Thank you, Sam. Marcia, the last one, there was a question that I thought looked interesting that was directed at you regarding measuring culture and the sorts of questions that you're putting in your employee surveys. And could you share a little bit more on that, and maybe others if after want to weigh in on that point? But yeah, that was aimed at you.
So I think it's questions like, you know, do you feel supported? Do you feel able to succeed? Do you feel that you can express your honest opinion? And I really like what my colleagues have said about taking the results of these things and translating them into action. And I can tell you that our senior leadership looks at these things. I mean, do you recommend working for RELX or whichever of one of our businesses? So those are unequivocal questions. But one point I wanted to make is that, you know, it's not one and done. It's not that we have one person in one team and that's going to be good enough. We really need to change the complexion of our organizations so that they're really reflecting the richness of the communities in which we hire and the complexion and richness of our customer base, as Kate was saying. So I think that's really important. And I just wanted to give a shout out to how things, you need the top and the bottom. You need the people like Kevin and Kate at the top of the organization saying, you know, this is the tone that we're setting. And then you need to be listening to people who are at the grassroots. And I just want to give a shout out to a colleague that I recently met, and his name is Elliot Paris. He said hello to everyone. And he helped to establish an Embrace Employee Resource Group. And I just love what they do. I just jotted it down off of LinkedIn, that embraces against systemic racism for humanity and empathy and pride and to be an ethnic minority in the workforce. Embrace believes in an intersectional approach to address inequalities, that we believe it is fundamental to embrace our vulnerabilities, connect with others, and foster a culture of allyship. It goes on, but I think that captures the essence of it. So I just love that employees are, they're really mobilizing, and it really has had an effect. In fact, our African Ancestry Network, after the George Floyd killing, met with the CEOs of our four business areas, and they came up with a plan, and stuff is really starting to happen, including allocating some cash to make a difference. So for example, through our LexisNexis Rule of Law Foundation, we're going to be doing work on eradicating bias and racism in legal systems. So, you know, the grassroots really makes a difference, and we need that leadership from the top of our organizations as well.
Can I pick up on that, Steve? Is that okay?
Sure.
I mean, Marcia, that is such a brilliant point. I'm so glad you made it, because we've been talking a lot about leadership and top-down leadership, but ERGs, employee resource groups, are absolutely critical. And we have 7 ERGs within MediaCom, and I cannot tell you how instructive they have been to me as a CEO all the way through this year. You know, they are the eyes and ears of diverse groups within our business. They are the voice of diverse groups within MediaCom. And one of the things that we have done this year is to really try and tackle the issue of microaggressions in business. So this is a cultural point, you know, how safe do you feel in our culture? You know, and a microaggression is a comment or a slight that makes you feel, you know, marginalized or put down. And we have run a campaign to raise awareness of microaggressions in our business. It's been a very honest kind of, I think, quite a brave thing to do. We've given examples of microaggressions that have happened in our culture, but the ERGs basically ran that whole project because they were advising on how we tackle it, which microaggressions we reference, not shying away from being open and honest about that. So they are so instructive. Me and my leadership team meet with all of the ERGs on a quarterly basis. So we're also putting them right at the heart of our decision-making as an organization. We had a session actually with them yesterday where they bring to the table, these are the things that we think we need to do. So I just want to violently agree with Marcia about the importance of employee resource groups.
Thank you, Kate. You will have all noticed another face on your screens. We are joined by Sanda Ojiambo, CEO and Executive Director of the UN Global Compact. Sanda, you are very welcome. Thank you for joining us. I'm just going to tempt fate, though, before handing over to you for closing remarks. I have one, a thread has been sort of forming in the chat and the Q&A that I feel I want to just get one more question out there. So maybe just really quick comments back on it. And it is the connection between ethnic diversity and gender diversity. And what is to be learned, I suppose, from the relative progress we've seen on gender diversity versus the slower progress? Are they on a similar progression, only ethnic diversity is just a few years behind, or maybe many years behind? The questions I wanted to draw on, I mean, one that I thought was really a challenging one was just about a perception from one of our audience that tokenism is only referred to when we're talking about ethnic diversity. Now, I know that this is something that has come up in conversations I've had around gender diversity as well, so I don't think that's entirely accurate, but it's certainly more accurate today than it used to be. The second point that I want to flag was just refers to the success of the Davies Report and how the Davies Report shone a light on gender diversity on boards, and in particular, the really poor performance of the FTSE 100 on women on boards. We've not seen the same impact from the Parker Review, which is effectively doing the same thing for ethnic diversity on boards. And should FTSE 100, FTSE 350 companies be stepping up? And I guess circling back to is this a place where targets, quotas, / tokenism has a role? Sam, do you want to take that on just to start? But we got to be quick anyway, so just maybe top line thoughts. Thanks.
Great. Look, as an organization, I think we've made good progress on our gender goals and targets and the progress that we're making in that space. In terms of the ethnicity and the correlations and how they link together, I think that there are similarities and there are similar challenges and there are learnings that we can take from the progress that we've made from having put out gender targets that we can bring into the ethnicity space. But what I would say and what I would call out is that everybody has a mum, or everyone has one or two people that are female that they can relate to. Not everybody has a black friend. Not everybody has a person of colour or a black, Asian, minority, ethnic, friend, family, associate, you name it. So there are differences when it comes to the two, and I think we should absolutely call them out and understand that that will also play out in biases, that will also play out in recruitment, that will also play out in the people that we have on our tables. So most people can relate to male and female, but not everybody can relate to a Black, Asian, minority, ethnic, and we need to be really clear on that. And that's where learning and education really comes into it, that we start to connect with people and help business leaders to connect with people that are different from them. And that's really, really important. And I'll stop there and hand it over to others so they have an opportunity to answer as well.
Very, very briefly, if someone wants to weigh in, or if not. Kate, were you getting ready to say
something? I've considered myself very lucky because I work in an organization that has very, very strong gender diversity. So I, at senior levels, we've had 6 CEOs of Mediacom in the UK, half of them have been women. One of them a Black woman, actually. But we're not there yet on gender diversity. I mean, I think the representation of women on FTSE 100 boards is very, very low. And we have to, you know, so we're certainly not done. It's a journey, as is ethnic diversity. But I think the thing to say is we have to overcommit to these things. Otherwise, nothing is ever going to change. So absolutely, we need targets and absolutely we need to overcommit. I really agree with what Sam's just said as well. But, you know, we have to put in place. One of the things that I feel I really benefited from was a WPP senior women's leadership program that I think helped me to get where I am in my organization. We have to overcommit and support minority groups, as we have done and continue to do with women, to push them into more senior roles and to help progress through companies. So I think there just needs to be, there's so much more work to do on both.
Steve, just to say that our pools of women in our organizations are, you know, they have a culture, they have color. So we need to look within those pools to see how the women who are Black, Asian, minority ethnic in the US, Hispanic, are faring. So it's not like ethnic, it's not like women, when we look at gender, don't have cultural backgrounds, they do. And I think maybe the one segue to Sanda is that we also have to look at inspiration. So we have, for example, through the UN Global Compact, the Women's Empowerment Principles, and a great new move is target gender equality. And so maybe working with UN Women and the UN Global Compact, we can begin to kind of dig into the point that I'm trying to make, which is, what's the color of those women? What is their cultural background? How can we make sure that those that are disadvantaged within the wider pool of gender, that we bring them up alongside the rest?
Thanks, Marcia. Kevin, very quickly,
we've got a staff diversity council, which was massively oversubscribed. 750 people applied for 23 places. They're very helpful in this. I completely agree with the points that my colleagues have made just now. I think it's about transparency with targets, but it's also about education. So we've launched into unconscious bias training for all our people. So I think you've got to have it from both sides. I'll stop there and let Sander speak.
Thank you all very much. And I'm going to say, Sam, Kate, Kevin, Marcia, this has been absolutely fantastic. I really enjoyed this conversation, and your candor and openness has been really welcome. Thank you very much. Sander, delighted to have you join us. Over to you for some closing remarks.
Thank you, Steve, for convening, I think, what is a very important dialogue. And, you know, it's just been great to listen to the panelists here and their insights and just, you know, reflect on what is a really critical issue. You know, just in thinking about this session, I thought about one of the most important things I've done personally this year, which was to read a book called How to Be an Anti-Racist. And read it along with actually the entire organization, the Global Compact team, and we had sessions around it, because I think one of the important things to realize is that we live in a society, and it's a very meaningful distinction, because how we fare in a society can't really be gleaned by looking at selective elements of things. And I think we have to just take a very inclusive approach to everything that we do, and always say that inclusive decisions will always lead to inclusive outcomes. So, you know, the challenge of being anti-racist and then the Black Lives Matter issue is it's a systemic one, and it's going to require systemic response. We're in a moment right now when the spotlight is being shone on this issue, but these actions must continue. And I want to applaud, you know, companies around the world who are taking concerted action, but it's not a project. It's not a work stream. This is life. We have to address this from a systemic issue over time. I'm glad to see that companies and leaders are taking, you know, taking it seriously, taking note. The simple act of looking around, Sam just mentioned it, you know, look around. How many people do you associate with that are of color and not just, you know, walking through the corridors, but have deep associations with? You know, what do your policies, your practices, and your procedures look like? The written, but most importantly, the unwritten ones, because I think that's where the biggest challenge is. And this, as I say, is really going to require concerted and long-term efforts. Targets are great, but they require a double click. What is under that target? It's great to have women of color at the table, but you know, what happens after that? You know, what are their levels of participation? What are their levels of engagement? How are they groomed through the system? Does a system even exist, you know, for this? And I think, so, you know, in everything, you know, let's always take a double click and make sure that it's meaningful, all of the actions that we're aiming to take. I think one of the key lessons that has emerged that I started with saying is that silence is broadly understood as being complicit, or worse still, some kind of agreement. And it's not to really suggest that anything you say is better than nothing, but you know, I have heard in some instances people say, oh no, but all lives matter. And that's not the issue. We want to spotlight an inequality, and it's a systemic inequality that has been going on for a very long time. I think it's very important that there's meaningful actions. And as I said, systemic change comes about. Empty platitudes, also something that we must, you know, not support. You know, this vaguely references the issue at hand, provides overly simplistic solutions, patronizing at best. Again, I go back to the fact that we must look for systemic responses. So I just think that, you know, there's three key actions that we really must do at this point in time as business leaders and leaders wherever we are, because I think it's real leadership that is going to drive this through. First, I think we need to get specific. We need to be open, and we need to back up our words with tangible actions. And I've heard a lot of the panelists speak about this from the short time that I joined. We need to call out the problem, and that has been going on for a while. We need to keep it top of agenda. It's race-based discrimination, and that needs to change. Leaders need to be candid, and they need to be clear around the issues. And that's why the simple act of saying Black Lives Matter is so meaningful. Because it's a very important and powerful starting point in avoiding the pitfalls of tone-deaf statements or empty platitudes, as I said. It's been amazing to see business leaders open up, because after all, you know, these leaders are people. They're actually people. They're humanity like the rest of us. And it really helps to show that we can actually address things from a very humane and humanity-based perspective. I think second, as I said, you know, we've got to be open. Talk about these issues within an organization, be willing to look at your statistics, analyze your statistics, double click on your statistics, be clear when it hasn't necessarily worked. You know, as a leader, you could have inherited an organizational situation, but the very fact that you're ready to put the issue on the table, rally employee groups around it, look at policies and practices is a great start, and it's a great way towards looking forward. As I said, it's systemic, it's historical. You know, brave as he or she who actually lays the issue on the table and takes it head on. And finally, you've got to back it up. And I think a lot of the panelists that I've heard you speak have shared lessons in terms of what's going on within their companies. And I think that is very important. No meaningful change comes from words alone. You truly have to act, demonstrate that willingness. And it could be small steps, but small steps will lead to change over time. In our organization as well, we're taking the opportunity to relook at our policies, practices, and procedures and make sure that we're always as inclusive as we should be, and also trying to drive that through our network of partnerships as a whole. So, you know, I think it's a great time for an authentic self-reflection as well as reflection within organizations. And as I say, get specific, be open, and back up your words, because Black lives do matter. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sanda. That's a fantastic note upon which to end the series. It's been a real pleasure, again, speaking with you all. Thank you to our audience. Apologies that we couldn't get to anywhere near all of the questions that were posed. It's really great to have you so engaged. It's been through the chat a few times, but all of the recordings of past sessions are available via our website, and this one will be there soon. Do please, if you found this valuable, share that link with your colleagues that need to be involved in this conversation. And we're going to have a resource note coming out in the next couple of weeks that will address a number of challenges. It's been an absolute pleasure. I wish you all a great rest of the day and look forward to working with you again in the near future. Thank you.
Thanks, Dave.
Thank you.
And a special thanks again to NatWest, without whose support, of course, this series could not have happened. So thanks for that. Okay.
Thank you.
Bye.